Good morning. Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning. It is good to be together to gather and worship on this third Sunday after Easter. Just a couple of announcements before we begin our worship service. The first would be that we are back worshiping in person in the Monongahela Church. And the only request we have is that if you plan to attend those services, to just call the church office by 5 o'clock on Friday so we can make appropriate arrangements in case we have to make some space to make sure folks are apart enough. The second announcement would be about the new Bible study that we're starting on this Wednesday at 6:30 on Zoom. The study is on the Gospel of John, and so we invite you to come and join in that study with us. We've had an engaging study just prior to this, and we encourage you to come and join and be part of this one as we begin this study of John. You can give us a call, or if you have questions about how to get involved and get connected via Zoom.
No need to buy an extra book for the study on John, just if you have the opportunity to read the first couple chapters. And now, let's turn our focus and attention on Almighty God. Join us in the call to worship. The Lord is our rock and our stronghold.
God is our refuge and the joy of our salvation.
Steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord.
When they call out to God, He answers them. When they turn to Him, He is swift to reply.
Exalt the name of God, for the Lord is gracious and kind. He heals the brokenhearted and gives strength to the weary.
Give praise to the Lord, for He forgives our iniquities and restores our soul. He leads us in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake.
hear our call to reconciliation. Christ has risen, and we have risen to new life with him. Yet we must confess the ways we have continued to remain in our tombs of sin and death. Let's pause for a moment in silent reflection. Let's join together in a prayer of confession. O God, our God, we confess we have not always lived for you. You have invited us into new life, yet we have closed our eyes and ears and hearts against that invitation. You have shown us the way to love, yet we have chosen too often the path of uncaring. You have called us to the ministry of reconciliation, yet often we find ourselves tempted to turn away from others. You have challenged us to generosity, but many times we would rather keep to ourselves. Enter our lives, God, once again. Release us from the bonds of self-centeredness. Create in us renewed openness to your love, that we may share your love with others. Amen. Hear these words of our assurance. In the cross, we see God's amazing love for us. We are God's children living in a confused world. So in abundant grace, God answers our doubt, heals our pain, and forgives our failures in grace. We celebrate, therefore, in the name of Jesus Christ, that we are forgiven and made new.
In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and set free in grace. Thanks be to God forevermore. Amen.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and
We come together now in a time of prayer. As we approach God, we share the joys and concerns we received online. In joys, we received an upcoming trip to the beach, good news for medical tests for Chris, the discarding of junk from our office, a visit from old friends, sunflowers growing in the house. And under prayer concerns for Larry, for an operation that is successful, and for moving to a rehab facility. For Jerry, who is recovering from heart surgery. For Julianne, who is in the hospital with COVID, but proceeding nicely. For JD, who's still battling COVID. For Doug, who is now in stable condition 6 weeks after his lung transplant. He's taking small steps. Praise God. Prayers for Tracy Marucci, a good friend whose brain cancer has returned. For her while she's at home and for things to improve. A prayer about gun violence. It never seems to end. For being frightened, especially for grandchildren. For Antoinette and Skip on the passing of Skip's sister, Linda. To Barb McVicker and her family and Paulette on the death of Al Hupchick, to be with them as they grieve. Let's go together to our Lord now in a time of prayer. Heavenly Creator, we deeply desire to live lives that will be in harmony with your plan for our world. We pray because our best efforts rarely succeed in that, and there are times when we fail miserably. We pray, Lord, that you would give us determination, steadfastness, courage, as we continue to do those things that would carry on your will. Because nothing is more important than that. Your love, your justice, your wisdom far outweigh all the other things that are going on in our society and world. In our world, Lord, we pray for those who are struggling. Particularly, we pray as we together, as a human family, struggle for solutions to this raging pandemic, to those other things that sometimes have fallen behind our view, the issues of hunger and safe water to drink, the places where there is open rebellion and fighting, for flooding, for those who are struggling with just basic things within their own family systems. We pray. We pray for your healing, for your mercy, and for your grace. We look at circumstances going on around our country, and we pray about those who have been victims of gun violence, even this week. We pray, Lord, knowing that we just don't understand. We pray, Lord, for those who are the perpetrators. We pray, Lord, for those that are the victims. We pray against the devil's schemes to seek to destroy and disrupt and to continue to try to steal the peace which you try to share with each one of us. We pray for those in law enforcement, recognizing this week as we pray that you would be with them. We pray, Lord, for wisdom and for justice. We ask these things even as we remember the life of Dante Wright in Minnesota. In the midst of that other trial that's going on, we pray, Lord, that you would bring about your healing. We don't even fully understand all of the circumstances. And we're sometimes so quick to judge one side or another. And so we pray, Lord, for your wisdom, but also for your justice. We pray for your healing in our nation, where there are so many racial divisions between different groups. We ask, Lord, that you would bring about your miracles to change that. We pray, God, that you would help us to be stronger in using the talents you've given us, that we might be those who would help to heal these frayed things, that we would be the ones that would stand up with courage, that we would be the ones who would be your sheep. Oh God, we ask these things knowing that sometimes life is too much for us to bear on our own, Remind us that you're the one who tracks our sorrows, and you're the one who keeps track of each one. You're the one who brings about the desire to proclaim love. It is your extravagance in your love story for us, in the empty tomb, in the promise, in the possibility of new life, in the celebration of your resurrection, that gives us and others hope. Let us be bold in proclaiming that. And as we take a moment to silently share those things that perhaps our lips can't fully articulate, but our hearts fully feel, that you would hear these our silent prayers. And now we lift up those things which we prayed about and shared at the beginning, those joys and those sorrows, knowing that you have heard each one, that you are with each situation, and that you, the lover of all, are bringing about healing, wholeness, restoration, and love. And now hear us together as we share the prayer that you gave us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Jesus, I've forgotten the words that you have spoken. Promises that burn within my heart have now grown dim. With a doubting heart, I'll follow the paths of earthly wisdom. Forgive me for my unbelief, renew the fire again. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on me. I have longed to know you and your tender mercies, like a river of forgiveness ever flowing without end. I bow my heart before you in the goodness of your presence, your grace forever shining like a beacon in the night.
God's living word, as is taken first from the Gospel of John and then from the book of Acts. John 21, beginning in the first verse. After Jesus appeared to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, it happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out fishing, Simon Peter told them. And they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat. But that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. He said, throw your nets on the right side of the boat and you will find some. When they did, they were unable to haul in the net because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple who Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish. They were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw the fire of burning coals, there with fish on it, and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared to ask, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus had appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said. "You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. I tell you the truth. When you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." And from the book of Acts, the 9th chapter, beginning in verse 1. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." He replied, "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias?" "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on the straight street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to him on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The stories we tell. Think of the ridiculous stories that a little person in your life has told you just to get out of being in trouble. Or think of all the excuses the teachers in our congregations have heard about why the homework isn't done or explaining an absence. And yet we all know, even as adults, we can be pretty sophisticated about coming up with an explanation, a story, when we get caught not doing something we're supposed to do. It seems as if as we've grown, what we've learned to do is just be a bit more advanced and clever about it, right? We want to move away quickly from that very uncomfortable feeling of being critiqued or having it be painfully clear that we've made a mistake. Now, while some of these stories are trivial, there's a whole other category of stories we tell. Stories we tell ourselves. Stories where we're trying to deal with guilt or failure or insecurity. Researcher Brené Brown tells us that whenever we're in a mess, whenever we feel anxious or hurt or know we failed, our brain actually immediately starts to come up with a story to explain what's happening. The thing is that most of these explanations aren't based in truth or reality at all, because many of them come out of a situation where we're feeling upset or anxious or ashamed, because usually it makes us feel uncomfortable. We don't share the stories. We never test them out. We just believe them. I'm just an idiot. I keep making the same mistakes. I'm never going to get anywhere at work. I know so-and-so never liked me. I saw the way they looked at me during that conversation. I always mess up. I'm never going to do this right. Why do I even try? We've all fallen, and we have skin knees and the bruised hearts to show it. But scars are easier to talk about than they are to show, and rarely do we see wounds that are in the process of healing. Throughout our lives, we've all experienced failure, disappointment, and heartbreak. But it's a funny thing, when you listen to most people tell a story about overcoming adversity, do you notice how they go straight from the setback to the comeback, conveniently skipping the messy part in the middle? That's part of what makes the scripture passages this morning an amazing gift to each of us, because it takes us from the stories of failure through the messiness of healing and out the other side. Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy. It's part of an ancient liturgy that many Christians use every week in worship by either saying it or singing it. It's in Greek for some reason. It never made it into Latin like the rest of the ancient liturgies. Essentially, what do we mean when we say, Lord have mercy? Some say it's asking God not to punish us for our sin, not to rain down fury or retribution on us. But knowing the loving and forgiving God that we follow, we don't think so. Maybe, Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy, Lord, have mercy. It's just shorthand for, please, we beg you, God, that our sin is not the final word. We beg you for your mercy to be with us, because ours is not enough. We pray for your wisdom to be with us, your loving kindness to be with us, because we just don't have enough of our own. And we keep messing things up. It seems that especially in situations where we are overwhelmingly aware of our shortcomings and smallness, that we beg this of God. Peter surely understood this, if anyone did. He'd been a common fisherman, and Jesus walked by and said, follow me. Peter dropped his nets and everything he had known and followed this Jesus of Nazareth. And with him, walking those roads together, Peter had seen great things, miraculousness, wonders, healing acts of power and grace. Peter was the first to call Jesus the Messiah. He was above all earnest in his devotion. And yet, when it came down to it, Peter, like so many of us, was unable to live up even to his own values and ideals. We know the story well. When the hour of Jesus' betrayal and death came, Peter could not be the man he'd hoped to be. Peter didn't bravely stay by Jesus' side like he said he would, choosing instead to slink away and anonymously warm himself by a charcoal fire. But you just can't warm feet that have gone that cold. And it didn't go unnoticed. He didn't go unnoticed there by the fire as he would have wished, because three times he was asked by a passersby, wait, you know him, don't you? And three times Peter said, I did not. He loved him, yet in the hours surrounding his trial and eventual death, Peter denied he even knew him. He was tested, and he was found to be wanting. Lord, have mercy. We simply can't imagine what Peter felt about himself after that. Could he have been filled with anything but unfiltered remorse and regret and self-loathing? How could he live with himself? How many times after Jesus died did Peter replay the scene in those hours in his head, wishing beyond hope that he could just go back and change it, to rewrite his own past? Lord, have mercy. Who among us can't relate to that feeling? In our gospel text for today, when Peter understands it's the Lord, he jumps into the sea and encounters Jesus on the beach grilling fish over a charcoal fire. We imagine it triggered a memory of another charcoal fire, a charcoal fire around which he warmed himself with his own attempted self-protection and against fear, denying his Lord and warming his hands. The irony is not lost on us. The context leading up to John 21 is intriguing. Jesus appeared, as we said last week, to his disciples twice since his resurrection. He'd already dealt with the unbelief of Thomas, but he's yet to do anything about Peter's threefold denial. Twice Jesus and Peter go together in the same room, and twice Jesus says nothing about Peter's failure. Peter was the proverbial elephant in the room for both those meetings, but the timing wasn't right. But on the shore it is, and it's also reminiscent of their first meeting. And in these moments, the resurrected Jesus Christ does such an unbelievably loving and merciful thing. Jesus doesn't rebuke Peter for failing him in his time of need. Instead, it gives Peter breakfast. Do you suppose that Peter was able to digest any of his food at breakfast that morning? And yet Peter is given by Jesus three chances to proclaim his love, one for each of his denial. Do you love me, Peter? And with the smell of the charcoal around him, could Peter possibly have answered yes without tears in his eyes? I failed you, Lord, and denied you in your hour, despite everything in me that I knew was wrong, but yes. And now three times, yes, I love you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy upon me. The adjective so often coupled with mercy is the word tender. But this mercy with Peter was not tender. This mercy was a blunt instrument. Mercy doesn't wrap itself in a warm, limp blanket. It is a powerful change agent. God's mercy kind of kills the thing that wronged it and resurrects something new in its place. In our guilt and remorse, we may wish for nothing but the ability to rewrite our own past. But what's done cannot be undone. The words we've spoken cannot be unspoken, nor the actions. Our past cannot be rewritten. But we're here to say that in mercy, God can redeem it. It's not easy. We cling to this truth more, perhaps, than any other. We have to. We need to. It is at the root of the good news, and we want to. For when we say, Lord, have mercy, what else could we possibly mean than this? All we know is that while Peter cannot rewrite his previous actions from before, we simply have to cling tightly to the truth that God can redeem them. Redeem them and make something new. What we're saying is this, that God knows the things in your life and mine that you're trying desperately to make up for. The things you hope no one will ever see. The word that, if used to describe you, would make you feel the very worst. That God who created you loves you even that part of you. We really think that's true. We believe that God knows who we are, where we came from, what we're trying to hide, and also what we will be. And God says, I choose you. You. The whole package. I went to the cross to claim not just the faithful, but the faithless parts of you. Because God knows it's not what they call you, it's what you answer to. And child of God is our own only truly eternal true name. Now, we aren't minimizing the unspeakable losses or the need for justice, but God is the God of Easter. Earlier, we heard the story of Saul's conversion. And as Acts tells it, Saul was traveling about hunting down Christians, like he was competing in some first century religious persecution of some competitive modern day contest that you see on TV. Scripture records that he had been present at and approved of the stoning of Stephen, the first martyr, and that he was on his way to round up Christians for jail and execution when he experienced and encountered the risen Christ on the road to Damascus. After the blunt instrument of God's mercy was done with Saul, he would be renamed Paul, as in the Apostle Paul, who then went to start many of the early churches and who penned most of the letters in what we call the New Testament. Who took the gospel from Jerusalem to Judea to the ends of the earth. Like Simon Peter, like Saul, we fail. The key is to fail forward. It might be shocking or at least thought-provoking to consider. God is not surprised by our weakness and our failure. An interesting quote we encountered along these lines is, when God puts a call on your life, he's already factored in your and our colossal weaknesses. All of that is to say that God can redeem anything and anyone and say, Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. It is about laying our hope in the redeeming work of the God of Easter, as though our lives depend on it, because they do. It means that we're an Easter people who know that Good Friday is never the last word. The final word is that resurrection, especially among those the least likely people and places in which God would redeem our mistakes, even out of the biggest messes that we make. John 21 and Acts 9 are good news for each of us who have failed as human beings, in our relationships, in all kinds of different pieces of our lives, failed as followers of Jesus. Part of that good news is that in mercy, God is way ahead of us, because Jesus is more committed to you than you are to him. In our relationships with Jesus Christ, the good news is that his is a long-term relationship to us, and his daily action is always in sync. Jesus doesn't fluctuate. He is 100% loving, 100% of the time, even though 100% of the time we don't deserve it. But it's also good news that Jesus doesn't question our long-term commitment when we have short-term failures. That doesn't mean he ignores those failures. But it's pretty amazing that even though Peter fails so big, Jesus gives him such a big job. Peter is the first leader of the church. We made some doozies of mistakes in our lives, and somehow the fractures and the lacerations caused by selfishness or anger or a sharp tongue, they're never the final thing. So here is the real thing to consider. God's redemptive work in the world in Jesus Christ is the final thing. So it comes down to faith. Either you believe God can redeem everything, or God can redeem nothing. We stand here before you, believing the former and not the latter, because of the sunrise of Easter. God redeems everything. The tomb was empty, and Peter, the Christ denier, becomes Peter, the rock on whom the church was built. Saul, the persecutor of Christians, becomes Paul, the apostle, proclaimer of the risen Christ. So, Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. For God can redeem anything. And to God be the glory. Amen.
Join me in saying what we believe in our affirmation of faith. I am called Christian because by faith I am a member of Christ, and so I share in his anointing. I am anointed to confess his name, to present myself to him as a living sacrifice of thanks, to strive with a good conscience against sin and the devil in this life, and afterward to reign with Christ over all creation for all eternity. We call him our Lord because, not with gold or silver, but with his precious blood, he has set us free from sin and from the tyranny of the devil, and has bought us, body and soul, to be his very own. And now receive God's benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Alleluia. Amen.